When you started to write, though, how old were you? I mean, to write really. I mean, not write the things that they tell you to write in school, but write because you wanted to write.
I reckon I wrote jolly well in the village school when I was about 8 or 9. No trouble at all. They'd say, you know, write a poem on Spindrift or an old witch or my holiday, which we never had any holidays, but you could make them up. I'd write 5 poems in an hour, and it never took any trouble. No. And it's got increasingly difficult maybe since then.
But did you actually like being set a subject?
Yes.
Yes, I
still like being set a subject.
But your background, I mean, according to Cider with Rosie, which is autobiographical, it was that you had a very noisy family. Now, in fact, I think this applies to quite a lot of homes, in fact. When you've got a lot of people around you being very noisy, you have to get some privacy to write, I think, do you? I mean, did you get privacy to write at an early age?
When you asked when did I start writing, we were all given these tasks at the village school. Right. Why did I keep on writing? It's because I could never get a word in edgeways. I had this large, noisy family, which you remember me writing about Inside with Rosie. There were three beautiful, large, noisy sisters endlessly gossiping in the kitchen. We were all on top of each other. There were three brothers, and I was the youngest but one, so I was right at the end of the queue when it came. And I wanted to say, you know, hi, something marvellous happened to me today. Hi, they say, sit down, fatty. You know, and they're sweet, but I mean, this noise, this I thought, well, the only thing I can do, I wanted to paint, I wanted to draw, I wanted to be a musician, but I also wanted to tell them what had been the glories of my day, the adventures. And the only way I could do this was to leave the kitchen and climb a tree and write it out in an old copybook, which I'd stolen from the local school.
Do you write with pencil?
Yeah, I've got a very... I've worked out a very sort of voluptuous way of writing, and also secretive way of writing, because writing is lonely, as you know, and it has to be secretive up to a point, because people don't believe that writing is work. And if I am known not to be writing, if I'm known by my family not to be writing, they think I'm just being a layabout. So I deliberately write with a 4B pencil, which is rather like driving a grey ghost Rolls. There's such thing. It makes no noise.
That's right, it's very, very soft.
And I write on the back of old radio scripts, which gives me no sense of squandering paper. And it's very soft, sort of Roneo paper. And I have gone to such duplicities as recording a typewriter and the stamping of feet across the floor so that everybody, you know, visitors say, oh, he's up there writing, we won't disturb him, when actually I'm just reading from an old Playboy or something. But the fact is that the typewriter syndrome, when everybody says, you know, if you've got a good idea, sit down at your typewriter. I never sit down at a typewriter. I write gently, softly, and nobody knows what I'm working or not. In another room or somewhere, there's this recorded typewriter going on. They said, he's all right, he's doing well.
I wonder why you've always written autobiographies. I mean, I wonder what that says about you, if it says anything.
I think it's largely because I have really loved the life that I've lived. And I've realized that if I didn't put it down, I would lose it. If I didn't, I write it to preserve it. I write it to celebrate both the dark and the light. But because every day to me is precious still, and I don't think we're going to get another time round or another chance, the only way to preserve this experience is to put it down on paper. It's the only way I can.
I mean, do you mean that by that? I mean that because if you don't put it down on paper, it's almost as if you haven't lived it.
I do, exactly. I mean that what you forget might just as well not have existed. Mm. And I keep notes a lot. I keep old diaries. Mm. I dug up one the other day. And I found something in there which was so startling and staggering. that if I read it, and it brought back a whole avalanche of feeling, emotion, and experience. If I hadn't found that book tucked away in my crowded workroom, I would never have remembered that, which was a very important experience, and I would have gone to my death never having experienced it. It would have been forgotten.
Yes.
And what is forgotten is lost.
When you write poems, do you have to have different conditions to write poems? I always imagine people write poems in the middle of the night.
Yeah. When she didn't turn up. All the early poems. I never wrote for publication. You know, I used to write to impress my girlfriends. I used to write to impress my sisters, maybe. All the neighbours, all my mother. And so many of them gone. I don't know what I would write right now to impress you. But writing at night was the great thing. I remember sitting in my bed, my brother, I shared a room with my brother till he was 20. And he'd say, "You and your smart thoughts," you know. And mind you, he was pretty good himself with his smart thoughts, but he had a small racing car and I didn't. He did better than I. He went to the grammar school and I went to the secondary school, so he was a jump ahead of me. And I used to sit there, and it was so easy writing through the night with the owls and the dogs barking across the valley. There was no effort, and it poured out. And it never occurred to me to publish anything. I was writing it because I wanted to show it to Joe or whoever and say, "Look, this is for you." Mm-hmm. It was something. I wasn't very athletic. I was rather tubby. I was known as Fatty Lee. I got very thin in my 20s. Thin, hungry, and gorgeous. But at that time, in my adolescence, I was very tubby.
Are you a romantic?
Are you?
I am a romantic, I think. Do you want me to define romantic?
Yeah, how do you?
Well, I think it's romantic of you when you got into a tussle with the police. Explain that. You know what I mean.
I got in a tussle with the police?
Yes. You were on a bridge.
Yes, remind me. Well, clearing up my den, my disastrous room, which I can't, there is not an inch of floor over it. Clearing that one day, can't throw anything away. Finding a lot of sub-rate poems. What could I do with them? To me, there is something semi-sacred about being given any line of poetry, even if it doesn't come off. So I found a number of poems and I thought, well, I must get rid of these. But they were handed down by the white winged goddess, even if she was a bit petulant that day. And I thought, well, I can't burn them. I can't put them in a dustbin so that the mayor of Chelsea gets them.
You can't rip them up. You can't rip up something that you love. No.
You can't rend them, because they still belong to you. So I thought, well, the only thing I can do is to take them down to Battersea Bridge and cast them on the sacred bosom of the Thames and let them be washed out to the great infinity of life force and so on. So right in the evening, we drove down. We got on the middle of the bridge. I got out, threw them over the side, went over, got the other side in Battersea, police van right across the road. "Stop, will you come to the station?" I said, "Why?" They said, "Some people have noticed that you're acting suspiciously." So, what do you mean? They said, "Well, we're getting rid of evidence or something. Come along to the station." I went along to the station and said, "Well, what were you doing?" I said, "I was casting some sub-rate poems on the sacred bosom of the Thames. Get rid of them." They said, "Ha!" One fell off his chair. And they said, "Well, what's your name?" And so on and so on. And they said, "Well, you know, we have to book you." And they did. And a week later, I got a lovely letter from the Metropolitan Police Commissioner or something saying, "Having taken all things into consideration, we're not proceeding any further with this matter." And by that time, those poems had floated down and up and down and up. As Alan Herbert said, it takes 3 days to get rid of anything, even love letters, and the Thames tides.
Tell me, it's occurred to me, do you think you want to be buried in the sea or in the water or anything like that?
I remember Spike Milligan once saying, he was giving away prizes, and he said, Chance, the great prize tonight is to be buried at sea with a woman, free burial at sea with a woman of your choice. Well, this horrifies me, not the woman of the choice, but being buried at sea, well, because I'm not, see, my father's people were all sailors, but my mother's people, who I feel much more closely identified with, are farmers, and I want to go back to the soil. I want to go back to Gloucestershire. I want to go back to the burial ground, which is above, up a steep hill, just above the pub in my village. I want to, and I got a little slot marked out there, and I got six great stout beer drinking cricketers, all named to carry me up the slope, and they're going to have a big part. I'm going to leave something for them in the pub, and they're going to take me up there, and it's all arranged, and they're going to take me up there. They're not going to have a drink before they get me up there, because I don't want to be spilled all over the landscape. But once they got me slotted in and they've signed, and the undertaker has signed safe delivery, they can come down and have a jolly good party. But I will not feel secure, even if I was abroad. I've arranged with the Arts Council, with a consul, with Henry Kissinger, with everyone, wherever I might be. And if I die, I've got to be shipped back to Slad and put in that little slot on the hillside.
Does that give you some kind of assurance, thinking of organising your death, about death, do you think?
Yes, it gives me the assurance of returning.
Yes.
To where I began. And though I've travelled all over the world, I must return to where I began. I must complete the circle.
You know, in your book, I Can't Stay Long, you've written an essay which gave me a great deal of thought. It was Paradise, it's called, and it's your idea of paradise. Do you remember the essay?
Yes.
And I've thought and thought about it, because I think it's a wonderful idea to think about what you think of as paradise.
What do you think of paradise?
Well,
what's your idea?
I thought of it, in fact, like almost like a sort of gigantic trailer of moments of my life that I would like to happen again. You know, I remember one moment where my three children, they were quite small, and it was, we were in the country, in the very middle of the country, and I remember my husband carrying one of them on his back as he was tired. Night had fallen, and there was a vast sky, absolutely crowded with stars, and my eldest son, who might not even remember having ever said this, suddenly turned and said, "This is darkness." Now, I'd like moments like that to relive them again, do you see? Mm-hmm. What is your idea of paradise?
Well, that was a momentary paradise for you, was it?
Well, that sort bliss of thing. But yeah. What I mean is that I think of lots of moments in my life that I want to just happen again. That's my idea of paradise.
The trail of paradise.
Yes, moments of love, probably, or moments of discovery, or something like that.
I think the paradise game, if you like, we call it choosing paradise game, is a great problem, because I think that hell is much better entertainment, really. Most paradises are just like living with your in-laws forever. You know, it's partly the church propaganda's fault, and because they wanted to frighten the wits out of you, they painted hell as being this, but hell is a Hammer film, and I mean, it's marvellous, you just sit there. But paradise is a kind of epilogue, it goes droning on, and it's this awful thing about meeting people that have died, or, you know, meeting everybody that you've ever known. That's not my idea of paradise.
No.
My idea of paradise is clean, the cleanness and choice, and with no sense of eternity, but of having illimitable restoration of one's powers and powers of appetite, health, and even flight, and friends who you can summon, as you could almost telephone them in a sort of astral way. They come and they go. And I think that the idea of choosing a paradise is much more difficult, much more intriguing.
Yes.
Than choosing hell. Hell is a good old blockbuster, and Christopher Lee with his teeth hanging out. But paradise, I think, is something that we should all try and evaluate for ourselves. I'm sure they're all different. They're not just standing around by the scrub-clean stock exchange in long white robes playing the, you know,
harps.
Welsh harps, yes.
But you also put a point in which made me wonder about whether you dislike present-day life in a way, because you said you'd also have a built-in music which you could switch on when you wanted to in paradise, and you'd never have a transistor in hearing, you said. So do you love the past and perhaps hate the present in any way?
Well, I don't think that was meant to be. It was just a kind of cleaning up. Technological advances have not always been to our advantage, have they?
No.
I love music, but I don't necessarily love other people's music. I mean, their choice. I was sitting on the beach, Weston-super-Mare, the other day, and they had on a certain radio program, full blast. It's like reading a magazine which you haven't chosen, full blast at you. So I switched on another program, full blast, and they after half an hour, they tiptoed up to the tea rooms, got rid of them. But my having it in the head is an extension of having an earplug. I think everyone who has a transistor should have an earplug as good manners. You shouldn't just unload it on others. But I think I also said that you'd have this music in the head, but you could share it with others if they wished. Because I think music, especially Beethoven, Mozart, Haydn, quartets and so on, we all try to describe paradise, but music is the nearest art that's ever reached a credible paradise.
Thank you for describing your paradise. And may I say to you at home that I hope perhaps paradise gives you an idea and we leave you with your thoughts of your paradise this afternoon. I wish you good afternoon.